Well, here I am, looking out over Freeway Valley, once again. It's a gray, cloudy day, as you can see. Rain gauge there has half an inch of rain in it. And I need to empty it, get rid of the water that's sitting there attracting mosquitoes. It's Tuesday. The 17th day of the month. The month of May. And we're having part of our very typical weather here. It gets cloudy so much along the coast here this month and the next month that we even have a nickname for it. We call it May Gray and June Gloom. It's just a little chilly, but I'm very well padded. It's one of our deep, dark secrets here in San Diego that we get a lot of clouds in May and June. Come here in January, it'll probably be nice and sunny and very mild. If you come here in August or September, it'll probably be very sunny and rather hot. But if you come here in May or June, the odds are better than even that you'll have cloudy gray skies, May gray and June gloom, our famous weather. January, February, March, April are usually very wonderful and warm and sunny. But May and June, all of a sudden, as the continent in the east of us starts to warm up, it starts sucking in the air off the ocean, and in come all these walls of clouds floating in off the sea. Yes, covering the sky. They flow off to the east. We just see the gray shadows. Once in a while, a little sprinkle, but not much. There's been more rain this year than usual because of El Nino. Not as much as up north, where it's rained so much that the bees have gone mad and are stinging people. Down here in the south, just have our usual problem with birds twittering and cars rumbling in the distance. I've been spending last week, I was working on my project of making the narration for the video installation at the Royal College of Art Studio Gallery in London. It's gonna be nearby Battersea, the old giant power plant, that whole area is being all redeveloped into urban millennial apartment towers. And one of the complexes building towers next to the river has given a ground floor retail space. For 5 years, they've given it to the Royal College of Art, and it is their studio gallery. And they put on shows there, month in and month out. Currently, the first of three video installations is up. And the one I have done the narration for will be up next month in June. The artist, he's a postgraduate student at the Royal College of Art. His name is Daniel. That's right, we've got the same first name. His name is Daniel Shanken. And I think he's a Yank, or rather he's from the United States. And but he's done a lot of work in Europe and studied there, and he was looking for a narrator. As near as I can figure out, he found me because I know for a fact, because he told me that he'd seen my videos at the Louvre, and he liked the way I just talked and talked and talked and talked and talked on and on, and talked about this and this piece of art and the palace and how I felt and what I was seeing and blah, 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 blah. So he wrote to me 2 weeks ago yesterday and said, would you like to do the narration? I can't give you any money, but I can give you credit. That is, he can put my name somewhere under the rug. And I would have said, I'll do it, just give me a round trip ticket to London and a hotel room. But I really cannot leave my mother much anymore. She has trouble just walking, and I drive her to get her hair done and go see the doctor when she needs to go see the doctor. She's going to the dentist on Friday, a couple of days from now. And even if I could get some of my stepbrothers and stepsister or my brother to come and spend a night or two here, it's not like it was a year and a half ago when I went to Paris. She was much better getting around then, able to walk and all kinds of stuff. Now she can walk, but it's a bit of an effort for her. And I just don't feel right leaving her. I mean, my job now is, I'm her housekeeper and her caregiver, and a few more months we'll be having some assistants coming in to help her take a bath and clean up and other stuff, get dressed. It's almost to the point where it's more than I can do, so we're going to have some living help for her. I mean, my mother's living here. We're going to have help coming in to help her living here. We're not going to have anybody living here, not yet. She's nowhere near that far, but she does need a little help, and she doesn't want me to give her a bath, and I don't want to give her a bath. And she does have insurance for home care, so we're about to the point where we're going to call the insurance plan and have them come and check out the house and do the interview and decide whether she's eligible. And she's sort of almost eligible, I don't want to wait too long, but I don't want to apply too soon and have them reject it. So at the moment, I'm making myself known to the insurance company. I have to send them a copy of the health management directive that my mother signed a number of years ago, naming me as the healthcare attorney. What do they call that? Attorney in fact, attorney in law, something. Power of attorney. Healthcare power of attorney. I need to send them that document. They said they won't discuss the particulars of the plan with me until they see that I'm actually designated to for this confidential information. Anyhow, that's in the cards for the next month or so, and it's also one of the reasons why I wouldn't want to go to London for a week or two. I don't want to leave my mother alone. And I toyed with the idea of I did ask her to go to London. She could afford it. And if I had been given a ticket, then she could have paid for hers and I would have had my ticket, but she's not able to make a trip like that. Even flying direct from San Diego, still, it's hard for her to walk, and even riding in a wheelchair with all the luggage and all that stuff, no, we couldn't make it. It would kill both of us. So we'll just stay home and be comfortable, looking out at Freeway Valley, and I will be glad that I got the opportunity to record the narration, and through the magic of the interweb tubes, I shot it across the world to London, and the other Daniel, the artist, is busy editing the narration and putting together a final version, which will be about 15 or 20 minutes long, and he needs to lip-sync the video, projected video, to the words I'm speaking, and then he's going to project this video of the museum guard. That's my character. I was a museum guard talking to myself all night long in the gallery. And he needs to project this video onto a printed three-dimensional statue that he's creating out of paper, I guess, or something. He said it's made out of 3D printing. And then he's projecting the video of the guard onto the sculpture. It needs to have the lips move in synchronization with the recorded narration. And meanwhile, all around the guard, projected on the walls of the studio, are scenes from demolition derbies, autos crashing into each other and smashing and flying through the air. And this, that's the art that the guard is watching. The gallery, once again, is called RCA Studio, or Studio RCA, and it's attached to the Royal College of Art in London. And the three pieces of art, the first one that's on right now with another artist, and then the second one with the artist Daniel Shanken that I'm working with, will be on in June, and then there's a third piece in July, and it's part of a series called Dusk or After Dusk or something, and it's set up so that people outside and walk by the studio gallery and look in through the windows and hear the sound and see the art through the windows, even though the doors of the gallery are closed, but the storefront is all windows, so there behind the glass inside will be the actual installation itself, and with the videos projected all over the inside. Maybe they'll be shining outside too, I don't know. I really wish I could go. I really would like to go and be there at the opening and say blah, 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 blah to people and listen to people saying blah, 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 and drink a glass of wine and eat the cracker. Makes me think of the elections. drink the wine and eat the cracker. Anyhow, I was pretty much busy the second half, week and a half ago, and last week, recording. I recorded a couple hours of narration and three or four pieces that I sent through the internet to Daniel, and he's working on them now. So my part is done. He's got the hard work ahead of him, putting together his work of art for the gallery. I find myself looking at the birds flying around. I just missed that one. It flew by. Yes. I missed that one. Pretty big bird. Flew around out there over the edge of the valley. They're always hanging up in the air, you know, how those raptors do, and then they stoop and then they dive down and catch their little gophers. This little piece of land around here that sticks out into the valley is called Indian Hill. And there's that bird again. Well, I think maybe that time we caught some of it. Some pretty big birds around here. We've got a whole set of crows that come around all the time, and there's some red-tailed hawks that live in the big trees. And somewhere around here, I believe there's even a pair of golden eagles, but I'm not absolutely sure about that. I do wish that bird would come back. Beautiful sight. I'd like to get a good shot of him. Anyhow, as I was saying, this video's getting pretty long now. I can't even tell how long it is. It's hard for me to read the fold out thing. It says, no, I can't read it. You can hear the birds, of course, and you might be able to see the yucca stalks sticking up right here. I've got quite a collection of yucca. Oh, there he is. Oh, I'm missing him. He got away from me. Anyhow, I was showing you one of the yucca plants here. Yeah. You can see the blades on the edge there. And then the stalk rising up. That's one of the local, that is, southwestern and Mexican plants grow around here, the yucca. There's another really good one right over there. Let's see if I can get in on that. Yeah, look at that. Oh, that's a beauty. They are also called the century plant because the lore is that they bloom once every century, but of course that's not true. They bloom whenever the weather's right for them. But they pretty much cover the hillside over here. They're very, very, very common around here. That and the nopal cactus and there's all kinds of stuff here. Some of it's exotic, came from other parts of the world, like the olive tree and the eucalyptus. It's hard to imagine California without eucalyptus trees, but they all came from Florida. Speaking of that, there's a couple of eucalyptus. There's one right there. The eucalyptus tree is everywhere here, but it's exotic. It's not from around here. It's from Australia. And of course, you know that automobiles are not from around here either, even though they're everywhere. Automobiles are native to Detroit, Japan, and Europe. Yes, although now they're making Volkswagens in Mexico, so who would have thunk it? Who would have thunk it that they would make Volkswagens in Mexico? But they do. Anyhow, I don't have much more to say. And there's probably not going to be a sunset, so I won't have anything more to say. So I will just say goodbye from Freeway Valley. I'll talk to you next time.